I just opened your mic. Hi, how are you?
Hi, hi, it's okay. How are you?
I'm good. Fine, thank you.
It's good sound, everything is good?
Yes, yes, the sound is okay. And how is your family? How are you about the virus thing?
Thanks God, it's perfect. Everything is all right in our country. Is very good situation, actually. So we don't have too many people down here, and this is easy for us to control everything. So I believe that after 1 month, we will be back like usual.
So probably in couple months, maybe the basketball will be there. How is the situation about the basketball in Latvia?
You know, this is like, we say crisis a little bit about the budget. Nobody knows what's going to happen next year. And the same way, nobody knows what's going to happen with the European competitions, you know, like, let's say Champions League, because there's so many different countries, so many different rules in every country. So it's going to be, I don't really know what's going to happen. So it's really hard to talk with players, even we know the budget and everything. So because they want to play somewhere. So
okay.
This is the point.
Yeah, we have a lot of questions that we don't know yet, the answer.
Yes, definitely.
While we're waiting for the coaches, I just asked the legendary point guard, Valdis Valters. What is he doing right now?
You can find him in YouTube, in Twitter, in all those social medias. He's really active.
Really?
Yes, but he's not a basketball too much. He's more about sport, but not too much about basketball. He's like, he's everything. He knows everything, you know. He's like, and always some conflicts and all the other stuff. So he's a great person. It's always interesting with him, you know.
You know, that time the USSR, not the fall apart, let's say. That time, while we are child, one of my legends, point guard. And I have a chance to meet with him in a championship, in European championship. Why the... I think his son is Christus?
Yeah, one of two sons, yeah.
Yeah, one of his sons. So he's a very legendary, for me, a legendary point guard in Europe.
Yeah, I was playing for him. He was coaching. And I was starting to be a coach under him, you know, under his supervision. So he was actually helped me a lot, you know, and I'm still thankful. And many times we talk to each other, so he's a big person for me.
Yeah. Okay, coach. Thanks, Fatih, that he made the touch with you. So you already prepared something. I heard about it. Now your turn. You can explain about your presentation, the subject of the presentation, and we listen to you. Thank you for coming.
Okay, thank you very much. Thanks, Fatih. Of course, I don't see him right now.
He's there. He's there.
He's there. Yeah. Like usually. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Thanks. So my subject is just sharing my experience. About how is to play and compete in VTB, and not only VTB, if you got a low budget team, you know, and this is my topic and this is my experience more or less. First of all, I really want to say that you guys doing great stuff, really great stuff. I think it's 51st time you meet together, or 52nd, yes. So it's like this is crazy, you know, and so many different people, so many different things, you know, and I watched some of those, and this is really great stuff you're doing, for sure. So definitely, if we need to play Turkey next year, it's going to be for sure very hard for us, you know, so everybody's going to know everything, yeah. So, So the short story, short background. So first of all, our team, EHF Riga, we are participating in VTV since the first year of the league, and time goes and our team changed. The budget go lower. They reduce the budget every single year, especially the last 5-6 years. But of course, you know, the owners and everybody, they still got this ambitious and they still want to be competitive, and also the league wants you to be competitive, and they don't want this minus 40, minus 50 games. So definitely every year it was a big challenge. How to find the ways, how to play with, let's say, with Česká, with the powerhouses of Europe, you know. And one thing is you lose, another thing is the way you lose, okay. And of course, sometimes you really want to win those games, you know. There's some reasons why we find it's very important to win those games, you know. And first of all is the structure of VTB, and also I believe is. The first league is very similar for me, like it's a Turkish league. I think there's a lot of very common things. But first of all is to qualify for a playoffs that we've been able to do 4 years. I've been coaching in VTB, 1 year in Champions League head coach. So twice we qualify for the playoffs. So it's 8 spots from 14, 15 teams. So you must understand that there's a 5 strong teams. Yeah, that's always on the playoffs. These are the St. Petersburg, Zenit, this is Unix, Lokomotiv, Khimki, and Česká for sure. Yeah, so these teams always play, always. Yeah, so you are fighting for the 3 spots with about 7-8 different teams. Yeah, even more sometimes. So definitely you need to win the games, that home games against your level teams, and some of the away games. That's definitely in a VTB's. It's not so easy, but of course sometimes you are lucky about that. But is every year the teams that's able to win those strong teams, they get a +1, +2 wins, so they are able to go to playoff much easier. And so to be able to go to playoffs, you need to win one of those 10 games, yeah, 10 games, or maybe 2 or 3 even of those. Yeah, and the same is happened with the big teams. Every team in VTB, they are fighting to be on the second, on the third spot. It's not that this year was different because Khimki played very well, but always Česká is the first. And if the first play against 4th or 5th place, they always win in semis. So the final is, so the first two go to EuroLeague. Yeah. So first two places go to EuroLeague. So you must go to the finals to get to the EuroLeague. Yeah. So let's say if you lose to the VEF, and that's the reason why you get to the 4th spot after a regular season. This is just crazy, you know. So is everybody approach those games kind of seriously, and this is really important for all those big teams, you know. And that's one stuff that you never find that they are lazy or something like that on that kind of games. Another thing I think is important to win those games, because that's the way how you build the confidence of your players. You know, it's a big confidence for the players. You know, we're talking about, let's say, it's not a normal situation. Yeah, let's say if you got a budget, that might sometimes be that their one player is, I would say it's like his year salary, his 1 month salary is like our team salary for a 1 year. You know, it's not a normal situation. It's not happened. Yeah, but of course this is not about money. It's not about, so the budget difference is so huge. Yeah, that's when you are able to compete and win, I think it's give a lot for the players about the confidence later on in the season, when you maybe some ways you lost a little bit. It's time to go back and say, remember guys, hey, we played that game, and just you get this potential, guys. You can get these games, you can play with Česká that game or Khimki, you get potential, guys. And so that helps a lot. And of course, another thing is very important for the GMs, directors, like a management of the team, is really important for them. This is for sponsors, is really important. Yeah, these games, this is something they really enjoy if you are able to win. Yeah, I remember also the 1 year, it was like All-Stars game. Yeah, it's All-Stars game. And before the All-Stars game, he was able to win, I think it was a Zenit team. So definitely our directors, the director, he was so happy that he can get to the All-Star game. He just get to the table with all the other people. Yeah, and he was like so satisfied about that. And that's a big credit for me as a coach also, that that helps a lot, you know. So these are reasons. It's very important. Yeah. What is the ingredients we need to win those games? Yeah, for sure we need the first the players who believe they can win, of course. Yeah, because I see the many players in my experience, especially those who like lost many times or those who more experienced, you know, they stop to believe, they stop to dream. You know, they are too realistic. So they say, like, inside their minds, they say, it's no, man, this is, I cannot win this game. This is impossible to do this. Yeah. And of course, with this kind of mindset, it's very hard just to go to compete. And yeah, so they are too realistic. Sometimes you need the naive players. With Americans, it's less problem because they know, don't have this, like, a history, this background. Yeah. And so you need that kind of players in your team that's still dreaming. They're still realistic. Yeah. And usually about a half of the team, if it's good, it's a half of the team of your players, they really believe that they can one day play in, let's say, in Himkö, Česko, EuroLeague, that kind of thing. It's very good that you get a half of your team is that kind of player. This means you get a very talented team. Yeah, but usually I get the two or three players like this, you know. It's very important to have a talent in offense. In defense, it's important, but not so important. Without offense, I never believe that you can go to win 70 teams that get a potential, let's say, like Moscow, Ceska. Never. Yeah, they never score less than 80 or 90. Look at the stats. Yeah, so you need to have this talent. I know that the one team is doing a lot about this. It's a Saratov. Yeah, it's a crazy team, but they always have a lot of offense talent. They play fast and look at the scores. And sometimes they're able to win those teams because they run like, and this is because of the offense. Yeah, I believe you can do it to the defense also, but I believe you need to have such a talent in offense to do this. Yeah, of course you need to be lucky. It's no matter. Is you need to be lucky. You can. The first is the schedule of the offense opposite team. Yeah, maybe they return back from the EuroLeague. Maybe they got the two games in 1 week. And maybe they got some. So you must be lucky because of this. It's a regular game. The same conditions is a very hard. Yeah, this is not too much about basketball. Yeah, but I always been following one thing about if you check all around the Europe and not only, you will see that there's like a 2-3 days in a row, might be sometimes 1 or 2 days in a row. Then you see that all these outsiders, okay, these underdogs, they are winning the favorites or they are very close, you know. And I really believe this is also about the stars and about just this is different topic, yeah. But I check it for a long time, and it happens. It happens that weaker teams is very close, get a lot of close games, you know. And I don't know the reason, but it happens, you know. Another thing is you need to have your best performance, and they must play below the average. And of course, one very important part is you need to have a player who can finish the game, and usually it's going to be small guy who can shoot the ball after the dribble, basically 3-point shot, maybe drive and kick. But usually you need to have this one player who can get a lot of these trash offenses during the games with the strong opponents, who can score those crazy shots when somebody brings him a ball in a 3-4 seconds till the end of the shot clock. Yeah, so that's some keys, very important. One thing, how we motivate the foreigners, yeah, and this is not so hard to motivate the foreigners in last years, because the agents talk to them and they work to them, and they know under one thing, yeah, they know that the GM, scouts and head coaches, they are looking to their stats and especially how they play against the strong teams. Yeah, everybody knows this. Every rookie coming to my team, yeah, usually they're coming to expose themselves, to show themselves, yeah, and they know. Yes, these games are important because everybody is going to check the stats. It's very good your player is smart and good enough. And if he's not, you need to tell him that they're going to look also to your team. Yeah, if your team is playing very bad, minus 30, nobody cares about your stats. It's for sure, 100%. Yeah. And another thing is very important. If your player is smart enough, foreigner is good, but he needs to understand. And I believe it's 30-70, 30% versus 70%. Yeah. What I mean about this, if player is playing without the team, he can play 30% maximum of his potential. From 100, if his environment or people around him is not helping him, or he's not helping them and they're not in order but helping him, so he can only have a 30% of his potential. This is everywhere, in business and everywhere, yeah, this is the law. That's if you got very talented guy, maybe 40% he can do alone. But if he's corporate, you know, he's playing together, collaborate with the other players, yeah, he can get up to his maximum 100%. Yeah, and this is something when you need to talk about foreigners, and not only, and they must understand, in order to win, let's say the chess or Himki, you must play together. Yeah? This is the only way, and that's how we talk about it. So it's a big challenge to convince the team that you can win something. I got some situations in my life that I got the 6 or 7 players going to Moscow. I know that we're going to lose. And I'm not telling them we're going to win. This is stupid. Yeah, I know we're going to lose. It's only 7 players, 2 players a little bit injured. Yeah, it happens with low-budget teams. It happens. 3 guys coming with us just to sit on a bench to look better. The bench is looking better that day. And this is crazy. And I'm not stupid. I'm not telling the players, hey, come on, we can win the game. They understand. I say, okay, let's try to win 1 quarter or 2 quarters. I still stay professional. I got maybe this kind of approach because they understand. And they will start to believe me. But normally we talk about how we want to convince the team. The first, I must believe that we can do. Yeah? And the easiest, for me, you're looking for the minuses of the team. You're looking for the opponent minuses. Everybody get the minuses. Yeah, this might be the tactical, but most of the times, you see they're not returning back, not very well. Whatever minus, and you exaggerate those minuses. You just say maybe it's just a small minus, but you take it as a huge one. So that's how you convince yourself, and that's how, if you believe, then your assistants start to believe, and everybody else start to believe. Okay, to convince them, we use the numbers. For players, on a film session, we use the numbers, statistics. We use the film to demonstrate video as evidence. Some statistics. Let's say we said last game, you see they play in EuroLeague or whatever in VTB. They got like 12 points they lost in fast break and 8 points they lost because they're not boxing out. So you maybe add a little bit more points because they're not gonna check it anyway. Yeah, so you add a little bit more points. You said like this and this, and this is going to be 30. You say, guys, so if you're going to work hard, you're able to get those 30. Just for the simple things. You don't need like crazy stuff, you know, like something that you never did before. Just 30 points because they are lazy about this or that. Okay, you show some or whatever. Yeah, so you must give them this feeling that they can win the team with the facts, with the stats. If you got a good examples, let's say, 3 days ago, some weaker team, like our level team, won them. So why can we not do this? Yeah. Or you as a coach been successful in past years, so, and you say, I last year, we won the team, and I know how to do this. Just follow me. Yeah. And this helps a lot. This helps a lot. Yeah. So if you get this, it helps a lot. Then we need to expect that the opponents, first of all, when the opponents coming to us or we are coming to them and they are facing us, it's not only about winning or losing. They know that they're going to win. They know this. They just get a plan to win no matter what. But they get a few more tasks. Usually they get a few more tasks. What kind? This first, they want that change a little bit rotation. So the players that play more, yeah, they can rest a little bit. Sometimes this is because of these limitations of the foreigners. They play with different guys, you know, but basically, and they want some bench players to play more minutes. So they change the rotation, a little bit the chemistry. Sometimes they want the player after the injury came back. Yeah, so they do something that's good for you, actually, you know. Coach. So that's the point.
Coach, yes. Could you tell about the limit of the foreign players in VTB? The rule?
It is 6 players. You can get like 6 players on a game. And in your roster, in a list, you can have like an 8. So.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. We get a 3. So no problem for me. 3 or 2 sometimes. Yeah. So this is the worst part of the big problem. You need big teams. You need to choose the players, you know, who sit on the bench. I don't have this problem. Another thing, the big teams coming, they want to do something more. They maybe want to implement or put in a game some new offenses or some offenses they're not playing before. They want to use the game for some more reasons. Yeah. It's obvious, yeah. Then it's for sure that, you know, when you every day like scouting video, this and that, and 2 or 3 days, 3 times per week, they want this little bit rest for their brains, for the players, especially in the middle of the season. I don't think that most of the teams spend so much time on a video or such a scouting before they coming to us, you know. So they don't maybe sometimes know what our 9th player are doing, if he's shooter or no, yeah. So it's normal. It's kind of normal. Yeah, I'm in, when we play in Latvian league, I'm in a different position. Yeah, I know this. Yeah, when we go to Latvian league, everybody expects us to win 30 points. Yeah, so I'm like Ceska in Latvian league, let's say sometimes. Yeah, so I know what is the mindset for these teams also many times, you know, and that makes sense, you know. And that's a point that's very important for us. I will try to share my screen. Yeah, so I got some. We will see some part like my experience with the three different games, okay? And after I will explain, or during, I will try to explain. I'm not very great at these things, but yeah. It's okay?
Yes, we saw it. Okay, we saw the mindsets over the tactic.
Yeah, that is very important part. Okay. So definitely these are the key components when we go to the highest budget teams. Yeah, the first, we're not thinking about tactics too much. There's no time to waste on tactics. We think how to install the right mindset for the players. First of all, no respect, but no over-respect. Okay, respect, but no over-respect. Okay, then of course, we prepare the team that we must play together. We must play consistently all the time. We must be ready to do the things they're not ready to do, okay? We have a lot of discipline, emotional discipline, okay? We need to have more huddles than before. We need to know how to handle the adversities during the game, because it's going to be a lot of the times we play the same defense like in previous game, but they're going to score because of their level, yeah? So those are things that is more important for me than the tactics, okay? Then the second one is the character. And the threats of the players over skills and physicality. Is normal that we cannot challenge the skills of these guys too much, or the physicality, athleticism, or all around what they have. Okay, so but there's things like, let's say, patience. Okay, is nothing that is no matter who you are in Himki, in Vet, in Kalev, I don't know where. It's the patience or collaboration between each other, okay, or communication, okay. Those are things that's not, you're not paid for those things most of the times, you know. So definitely those are things that everybody must agree is very important in basketball, you know. But you can try to more times to attack those characters, those threats, you know, during the game. Is more also the readiness to be outside the comfort zone. Yeah, when the players coming to the game, yeah, so we will offer them really something that's out of the comfort zone. We will try to do this. We are ready to be there. The question is, are they ready to be there? Yeah, and another thing is do the things that opponents are not ready to do. And let's say this is 50-50 balls. Yeah, these 50-50 balls after the game, how many times we jump, how many times we dive, and how many times we've been on the floor, and et cetera, without that, it's very hard, you know. So we need to do them longer. Everybody know when we go to these games, if we get like three minute relax, is no way you can be competitive at the end of the game. There's no way. Yeah, we need to have a high effort level, higher than the opponents. Yeah, in order to do this, we always keep our players fresh before those games. We're not even practicing sometimes day before, or only very short shooting. And 2 days before also, it's very short, but a very high level, quick fast off, fast, short but fast, yeah, to adjust the speed of the game. Yeah, but we always fresh, always fresh. If is if you are able, of course, because of the plan. Yeah, and one very important thing is our players must be ready to sacrifice the body, their body. You know, they're, you know, the big teams coming. You know, they last thing they want to get an injury. Last thing they want to have a lot of contact. Last thing they have like a fight with somebody all the times because somebody get a problem with his shoulder, somebody with a knee. Yeah. So they more think about what's happened after 3 days many times. Yeah? We don't have this problem. Okay. We can sacrifice our body. We can offer them high level of contact, many times touching each other, and we looking for the response. And the response sometimes is something that helps us. And we will see it a little bit later. Okay. And the most important, or maybe one of most important things, is the maximum simplicity on our game plan. Because we know that the game gonna be the speed that's above our regular speed. So players will get uncomfortable playing that speed. The athleticism, the way they think, that's so fast thinking, so fast moving the ball, do everything faster than we used to do. We cannot model this during the practice. We cannot do this every before. So it's going to be something that we're not good at, you know. So if we need to think under those kind of conditions, I don't think that thinking going to help us. It's only reactions, it's only instincts. So the instincts, fundamental things, simplicity, this is something that's really important when we talk about all the tactics, okay? We go to defense and then we go to offense, okay? So the first thing we do, we diminish the responsibility. Okay, I will explain what I mean about that, and later on I will show you some of those examples. So I will give a for players. Let's say if you play against De Colo, you will not tell he's doing this, he's doing that, he's doing great that, he's doing everything great. You know, you just tell the guys. Let's say if they play pick and roll, it's just a one example. So we need him to pass the ball. That's it. That's your only example. I don't care what else happens. He needs to pass the ball. You know, or somebody else, maybe very good 3-point shooter. We said, okay, no matter what, never let him shoot the ball when he runs out of the screen. Yeah? Everything else, this is my responsibility. But your job is never let him shoot the ball. But do this always, consistency. Yeah. So we don't give him like the lot of the things, just the one or two things. Okay. Our regular defense, regular rules, of course, no layups, no fast breaks, no second chance, all the other stuff they do every day. But we don't make like a lot of those rules or all the other stuff. Yeah, I get a lot of responsibility as a coach, I tell them, and they really are clear and they understand what they need to control and what they not control. And about those things they not control, they not get frustrated, okay? Or I'm as a coach encourage them, even these guys are scoring those crazy shots. Before that, we just as with the coaches, with everybody, we understand what is our risks and why we risk that way. Yeah, but this is something that we clearly understand which defense is good and which defense is bad without judging they score or miss. It's no matter they miss or score. Yeah, if we did well, we did well. Okay, and that's something very important because you can become really negative during the game because they will score many times in different ways. But if you're consistent in some parts and you do this always, and even if they score from the other situations that we cannot control, you say, okay, guys, you did a great job. Nothing to do. Okay, so control over one, two areas. If you talk about numbers, one thing, no free throws. I really don't want them to shoot the free throws, the opponents. Okay. That's why we usually offer limited aggressiveness. Limited, okay? We don't want to be over-aggressive or be in a level of aggressiveness that we cannot handle. Because these guys playing against us, they know how to use their bodies, how to show fouls on the contacts. Usually refs a little bit more respect those guys. Yeah? So it's stupid if we play against great team and they go 30 times to the free throw line, and they score and that's why they win the game because we've just been too close to them on the wrong situation. Yeah? So definitely we need to have a limited aggressiveness. Of course, some players we want to be more aggressive, but not over aggressive. So no free throws, okay? And let them shoot from the 3-point line. more, okay? Because we get more chances. Let's say mathematically, yeah? 60% of free throws, 60%, this is very low shooting, yeah? Is the same as a 40% three-point shot. But the possibility that they will score 60% free throws is much higher. And it's something we cannot control. Yeah, so I prefer them to shoot three-point shots because I got a chance that they're going to miss at that single day. Okay, so let's just push them away from the line and let them shoot the three-point shots, especially the sum you can control. But it's a very important how we want to control the shot. Yeah, if he's stupid, if he think that we can came, let's say, about play against Sergi Rodriguez and just go under and think that he's going to shoot the ball and he's going to miss the ball. Yeah, because only he's not prepared. No, yeah, he can blindly, I think, score. But if we put the right pressure on the player, or mental or physical, or we're going to let him shoot the ball he don't want to shoot, I think we get a little bit more chances that he's going to miss the shot. Yeah, and mostly of the times we want to attack those players, the mental side. This was just a one example with Rodriguez, and I think he's a composed player, but the many players is really bad response to the contact. And from my, what I see also this year, I think the Žalgiris, one team, Žalgiris, is doing the great job about just a lot of contacts during the game, great response, okay? And just they get a lot because of it. Yeah? And this is something that we've been doing for 3-4 years many times, just to respond to the contact. Another thing is the defense, that's we want disruptive defense. We want them to change the roles, that sometimes they do that by themselves because they're changing the players. Yeah? The second point guard play more than the first. We want them to shoot from the different rhythm and shots, you know, when they come again, play against weaker team, they want to get a good shots, easy shots. They're not ready to take many times the hard shots. Yeah, they want to good shots. Yeah, and if you give them 50-50 sometimes, and before that you do your preparation, yeah, let's say the contact or maybe sometimes aggressive defense at that single player, yeah, or maybe you try to change some rhythm because you play different defenses on a point guard, double team or something else, so he pass the ball. So definitely I think this shot sometimes they don't want to accept. Okay, so let in few words, let them prove that they're better because they shoot hard shots and they got a great play. It's not because they just come up, win because of rebounding, layups, fast breaks, or free throws. Yeah, if they got a class, they must prove the class, not because the free throws, not because we are making the mistakes. Okay, I will give you the example about how we treat the sweat. Okay, first of all, this is what something we wanted. Okay, we wanted maximum amount of contact. Just every time he moves from spot to spot off the ball, without the ball, he must feel the contact because he don't like. Shved is the special player at the Himki. It was the past season, yeah? Because he's like, you know, his mindset is all very simple. He wants to win, but more than that, he wants to score because he's every time the first in scoring in league. He wants to score. So that's his mindset. He will not finish until he will get a 20 or more points. This is his, and of course he wants the passes. Okay, so considering this, we choose this tactic, okay, to frustrate him because of lot of contacts. Every time he wants to step into the paint with the ball in his hands, he must feel some contact. Okay, if he wants to go full speed, he must feel a contact from the another player. Yeah, so we just build a wall in the front of him. But one thing is very important, we do not want to foul. Because we see many games, he scored like about 90% free throw shooter, some 7-8 shots from free throw line. Okay, this is a lot of. Okay, then some easy cuts and everything, few more points. And then, of course, from him, it's very easy to get those 20 or more points. But if you keep him zero on free throws and try to avoid any easy points, no easy layups, so he must work hard to get those 20. Okay, and that was that. So we wanted attacking his mindset. Okay, then we didn't want him to pass the ball directly to the paint. So he got an assist no assists. He need to pass the ball to somebody else, and that somebody else will pass somebody else. Yeah, because he likes to risk. He wants to assist. Okay, his mindset is more about, let's say, I'm not a selfish player because I got the 9 assists. And but maybe he not thinking too much about the extra pass. And so this high level of risk, especially when he plays against the weaker team. And of course, then he will play a lot of one-on-one. He's a strong side, one-on-one, shooting the three-point shot. So we will bring the build the wall in front of him. This is our scouting, what we did before the game. So this is one thing we said, no. This is our responsibility. No fouls. Contact, hands up. And this is the second thing we said, no. No direct pass in the paint. Yeah? No direct pass. Okay, he's passed to this player, no problem. Yeah? According to rules. But no direct. And this is the one thing we wanted. Yeah? So we build a wall in front of him. We protect the paint. We let him pass, especially in this kind of situation where we challenge his left hand passing. Yeah, he's a good trajectory for pass for the defense. Yeah? So, and this is no clear shot. No clear shot. Yeah? No shot immediately. So this is very hard for his mentality. This is hard for his mentality. He loses the patience. He starts to risk a little bit more. Yeah, you see again the same story. Yeah, so we want to build the wall in front of him, and that was one. This is the scouting we did before the game. Yeah, again, once he steps into the paint, okay, this is not a great contact, but this is the player's try to avoid the fouling. But no pass inside. No pass inside. If he's pass inside, it's not going to be assist. So we challenge his will to have this crazy good stats. And this is how we want to play isolation. Yeah, this is a little bit part of our tactics. Okay, and the one thing, you see the player 24 in the defense. So he want to be over aggressive, and he don't want to let Shred to shoot these rhythm shots, let's say two times between legs, step, sidestep shot, or whatever his shot is, you know? So he wants to be over aggressive. He don't want Shred to see the court. So he exactly understands the spacing and which player are standing where. You know, he wants to attack him all the time, knowing that he's gonna drive. And we as a team expect him to drive. Usually we force him to left. And we challenge right now when he drives, you know, the next player is ready to meet him very high, you know. So we let him pass the ball to the opposite side, to the left, to this closest side corner with his left hand. Yeah, this is the bad spacing here. It's good for us. Yeah, but that is our idea. So if he shoot the three-point shot, it must be really hard shot. This is the game. This is the game after the scouting. Okay, so check the first differences. Yeah, the one player for us, he number 15. He tried always to have this contact with the Shved. Yeah, it was like a 3-4 minutes every time Shved wants to touch the ball, he wants to move somewhere, somebody screen somebody, or even receive the ball. We offer him conditions that he needs to work really hard. He needs to have a lot of contacts. This is next defense and next offense. You see right now. You see, yeah, he's already out of his mind a little bit. He lost the composure. Okay, this is one mistake defense. Yeah, reaching foul, 2 free throws. In this game, 3-1 free throws for him. 3 free throws, 1 he scored. Okay, in this game he scored, let's say 12 points, and that is, I think, the second smallest scoring result since that game. Yeah, one game I think he scored 10 after. Yeah, so we did great. He's going to make a cross screen, so he needs to work hard. Yeah, we attack him. His mentality, not his ability to play basketball, but his mentality. Okay. And another thing is bad defense here. Yeah, is a transition, not good communication, stepping into the paint. We give this mindset for him. If you want to go to paint, you will meet somebody there, and it's not gonna be very pleasant. You will feel the pain, but you're not gonna be awarded with the free throw shots. Okay, good defense here. And one more thing, every time is a full speed drive, he must feel somebody in the front of him. There's a 2 full speed drives in this game. It was only 2 of them. Yeah? So I think because of all this we did, he lost his aggressiveness and he didn't have easy points. One more situation here. We recognize isolation. We build a wall. We build a wall. Yeah. We don't want him to shoot the three-point shot. We didn't want to shoot him three-point shot. Okay. What about those players around him? Of course, depends. More help, less help. But in this year, him he got a lot of players not capable of shooting the ball, like Markovic right now. Maybe in different game he gonna shoot the ball, but not in this game, you know. And when it's happened the game, Schwed sometimes pass the ball for open player, and if you miss one or two times, we feel that the chemistry is broke, you know. So the will to shoot and will to pass, they lose both of them. Okay, so it makes sense. This is the isolation situation. Something we said about the wall. You know, our big player against Schwed. Okay, no easy shot. Okay, and right now is very important for the rebounding. I think this is too easy shot. But anyway, the team is ready. And this is the, you see, fourth quarter, 1 minute left, plus four, minus four for Himki. And this is what kind of shot Schwed use. You see. Not very great for me. For me, very good. Yeah, for them, is not great. Yeah, because I think he lost his patience. He know that if he needs to work, he needs to work hard or pass the ball for somebody else. So he's lose the patience because of that. You know. So I think that defense was quite a good at that game. Okay. Now, one defense we want to use really often, we call it provocating style. Okay, it's not about provocating physically, it's about provocating the players to shoot the shots they really don't want to shoot. We broke the chemistry, we pushed them out of the rhythm. Okay, how we do this, like in previous example, might be we want to be more physical, it's a different ways. But we don't want to player play the way he always plays. He must play different way, and we give him them shots many times like this. Okay. Except the last 4 or 5 seconds that we really don't want them to shoot the ball, because those are low responsibility shots. And because, you know, this is just, you get a ball in 4 seconds left, so any shot you shoot is good, you know, so players don't feel the responsibility. Okay, so, but the one thing is really important, we want to control the rebounding. Yeah, so if we want to give a shot, we want to control the rebounding. Okay, so the first thing, we push the players or the team out of the usual style, of the usual mindset of the player in different ways. Second, we let them shoot the shots they don't want to shoot. Yeah. Let's say if you get a great pick and roll player who likes to pass the ball and little bit shoot the ball, yeah, so we will give a shot. You got a player who sometimes you checked in a scouting report. This is all the games he never shoot more than three-point shots. So you get a question, what about letting him shoot 4 times or 5 times or 6 times? You know, how he gonna act? Because in the last 5 years, he never shoot more three-point shots than twice. Yeah? Or there's some players, when they miss the one shot, they never go back. They never shoot again, you know. Especially, you know, like in Russia, same like in Turkey, you know, so domestic players, they are different level sometimes. And this is just a big difference between foreigners sometimes and local guys. Yeah, so you find the one or two of those guys and you just let them shoot instead of those half million or million players shoot the ball. Okay? So there's a different ways. But as a team, we know how long we're gonna stay to this provocation. Okay? If we go under consistently on one player, if he scores, let's say twice, we change the defense. We go to the plan B. So we know how long we're gonna provocating, and we provocating, and it works only if we do the preparation. Yeah, we attack him, attack his mindset, yeah, or change the rhythm of the team. So different players choose the different shots. And this is one example when we play Champions League this year. Tenerife is the opponent. Okay, so we talk about how to play against Marcelinho. Our preparation was that we don't want him to pass the ball to the roller, of course, that's a Shermandini, okay, and we don't want him to pass the ball to the wing players, to the arc, because from one pass away, they shoot really great. But if he needs to shoot by himself, he's not so well. Yeah? So first thing, in this example, we put a one player, we have 7 players this game, yeah? 7 players on a bench, on a team, 2 on a bench. So we put a one player to work hard against him, but not attack his mentality, but physicality. You cannot attack his mentality. He's smart enough. and he will not lose the composure so quickly. Yeah, but you want him to play. You considering that they play different day, like 3 days ago in Tenerife, and they travel. He plays all the games 25 plus minutes. He always play maximum speed. Considering all those things, you know, you understand that in his player in his age group, whatever, maybe he's really fit, but this is really hard to always be in on a maximum. Yeah, so we attack his physicality, not his mentality. We really attack his physicality and give him and let him shoot the ball many times. You know, we need to cross the ball 3 times, crossover, whatever, to just to bring the ball to opposite side, then play the pick and roll and shoot some floater shot. Yeah, this is much easier for us than, let's say, play and offer some against one of the best pick and roll guys to offer some pick and roll defense. Yeah? This is whatever we are doing on pick and roll defense. I think he knows how to play. So we give this shot, but the problem, the thing is, we need to control it. We need to control rebound. Okay? This is other players, yeah, in this team especially, this is a 32, 31, and they're not able to shoot the ball because you saw, like in the previous games, they never shoot the ball in the first if somebody's go under. So you're able to go under and you provoke them to shoot. You said, okay, twice they can score. The one player can score twice, time, two times. If he scored 2 times these shots, okay, we will change to this player and we're gonna play the different defense. Okay? But they hesitate. They hesitate a lot. They didn't want to shoot the ball exactly immediately. And many times it leads us to that kind of offense. 5-6 seconds left, 1-on-1. So that's very structured team. Is Tenerife is not like a typical VTB team, and it's a different team, but also great players. And we wanted this, no problem. But you see, not leaving right now our big one-on-one on rebounding. It's very important part. Yeah, is rebounding must be 2-on-5. Somebody can toss or tip the ball, whatever. It's very important. If we let them shoot the ball, we need to control rebound. And last 4-5 seconds, if we switch, and there's a one important part. Yeah, on this shot, it's very important that the big player right now, number 9 in left, he's helping to the small player on rebounding. It's very important. Yeah. In this case, it was really hard, but we've been better on not letting him score second chance. This is one more example here. Yeah? Okay, he shoots. If he scores twice, no problem for us. Yeah, but 3 times, we will change. And you see rebounding. And that is a crucial. Because you see 32 points in the first half. In the game, they score 68. This is the lowest in Champions League this year for them. Yeah. And I think in ACB twice they score less. Yeah. And again, you see, player starts to just, he's not shooting, he don't know what to do. You know, he don't know what to do. So going under, this is not an easy, of course, for the players technically and everything. Yeah, going under, whatever the big is doing, his retreat or he push, is not easy. You need to have a good technique in order to do this. Yeah, and something we need to practice, to how to go under. But many times when we go under consistently, one thing happens for the big player, you know, offense team. Let's say if the big player is good roller and we go under consistently, he will never get the ball. So he makes a 22 pick and rolls, he sets a 22 screens, but he never get the opportunity to score. Okay, so he starts to make a very passive screens, or he starts to make a very great screens. And especially when you go under, you know, everybody want to make a better screens move. And 1 from 3 screens, usually they are fouled. Okay, and this is also sometimes happens. And in this game, is a problem happens later. Okay, yes, they scored this one shot. He put a little bit more leadership and we lost the aggressiveness. But we stopped to being consistent. Yeah, one time he scored, next time we started to help too much. Yeah, we needed to give him again the shot. No problem. Let him shoot again, different shot. Okay. But we started to play for help from the weak side because the big player was too high. So they scored 2 different ways right now. So this was their responsibility. It was not my responsibility. It was their responsibility. Yeah. To not let them score this shot. And another thing happens that this was a big problem. We let them shoot and they get a second chance. And they score because of the second chance, and at the end of the day, they win that particular game. Yeah, so definitely we was playing good, but we lost the consistency and we didn't control rebounding at the end of the day. Yeah, and many times you can play also not against the great teams, against not only against the bad shooting teams. You know, this defense many times just this is help us a lot of times when we play against really strong teams. You know, and not only. What else we can do? Usually if we get problems, we try to prepare some matchup zones, just as some house. Just something that, you know, when you see that, let's say, some more structured teams, Unix came to us and they play 16 seconds offense and they want to implement the new offense. The new offense, they never played before or they play rarely. So, and you put something like some matchup zone, even it's not a perfect. Even you never practice like 2 weeks. Yeah? But they cannot do what they want. They cannot just work on this offense. Yeah, and this also sometimes make a trouble for them, you know. And of course, the switching defense many times helps, especially many times we change the position 4 and 5 before. Okay, so 4 is playing with the 5 and 5 is playing with the 4. So, and we get, let's say if in this game, Huertas is playing very good on pick and roll, we go to switching defense. Yeah, and our 4 gonna defend their 5. No, and we will switch with Huertas, and we will try to make a double team inside because our 5 gonna be somewhere. Okay, so we maybe leave the 4 open, or we're gonna try to rotate to the 4 from somebody else. Yeah, so we just get a different strategies. Yeah, but this is the plan B most of the time. Offensively, also simplicity. So we want less turnovers. Like everybody, of course, and we will have a lot of three-point shots. But we really, really say, guys, we need to shoot every time. You get a chance, shoot the ball. You give him a total freedom about shooting the ball, whatever situation. Usually, we sign the players who can shoot from 1 to 4. Yeah, it's very hard to play player cannot shoot 1 from 4 in VTB. Yeah, for us, but one thing is very important. If you shoot, guys, you shoot with the confidence. If you don't have a confidence, don't shoot the ball at all. Okay, shoot with the confidence, and 3 players must for sure crush the ball. So this is very simple. Yeah, like Canadian ice hockey team. They just put a puck inside the opposite side, and everybody go to fight for this. But this is no way we can make the turnover on this. Okay, so we make this simple way. Okay, simple way, very simple way. Of course, in order to get a shots, we need to work a little bit harder. But mistake for us is not to shooting the ball or not to crashing the board. Okay, if you're not shooting the shot, this is the mistake. Okay, and we talk about soft crash. Yeah, this is soft crash. It means that this is just 3 players is going. Yeah, 1 is usually the big. He's somewhere in the paint, and 2 players not go running back immediately, but they are running like through the paint or through the elbow. Yeah, so these long rebounds, usually you can tip them to the safety guy, or you can grab them sometimes, and then the one more shot usually is something you're really looking for. Okay, so. I know this is NBA, the numbers is different because this is different rules and different athleticism of the players and skills and everything else. And of course, the analytics never let go 3 players for rebound. This is stupid, yeah, if they do this. But in Europe, it still work, you know, and it's work really well because by the numbers, let's say if you shoot a transition shot, that's the highest percentage shot, 3-point shot in EuroLeague last season, 40%. Yeah, you got that 1 for 3 offensive rebounds you can get if you miss. Yeah, so this is just a, and then you get the option to shoot one more time again if you're really quick to stretch the court and passing to each other. Yeah, so I think it's not very complicated. It's very simple. It's just you need to be confident. You move quick. You know, you just to go contact. It's easy. Everybody can do this. Yeah, almost everybody can do this. Yeah, it's not so complicated for the players to do. Okay. And of course, one very important thing is to attack the mental weaknesses and bad habits of the opposite side. And that's what something we will talk later. This is one example we play against Zenit. Okay. One game. What we talk about. what we talk about, shots and rebounds. So these weak side shots must shoot for sure 100% every time. Yeah. So we want to extend their defense. They are very athletic. We want them to be wide. We want them to respect your three-point shot or over-respect your three-point shot. So they will go very aggressive on a close-up. Okay? Because you shoot, and not even if you miss, but you shoot with the confidence, mostly of the players, they start to over-respect your three-point shot. So those kind of close-outs, you must shoot the ball most of the time. Okay? And then there's a job for the big player. He must seal. He must offer every time. Every single time, he must go and offer really hard contact. Yeah. Under, small player must shoot the ball immediately. Yeah. Three players rebound and looking for the one more shot. You go for second time. Weak side overhead shot. Yeah. So this is something that's just a simple. And later on, when they start over respect your 3-point shooting, yeah, they start to make a flyby, and you get able, because you seal, you get able to go and attack the paint and make a different ways how to score the basket. Yeah, but from the first, you make a threat from the 3-point line. Okay, what kind of actions we want to attack? We don't want to think about too much. Hey, they play bad. This kind of defense, we need to run this offense. We choose three or four of offenses with a very simple pick and roll. And we try to run this multiply times. Every time we run pick and roll two or three times. Okay, not over complicated, just very simple. What is very important, we always know that we're gonna be in a good spacing, because mostly the turnovers happen because of the bad spacing. A lot of turnovers happen because of the bad spacing or because of the player over risk. He wants to make some risky things. Okay, so we like to play very simple, two, three times pick and roll, maybe some of Spain pick and rolls in the middle of the net. So maximum number of the quality pick and roll plays, but no fake pick and rolls. Never, we always ready to attack. We're not ready to risk, but we're ready to attack. Okay, so we get a chance, we play. And what is a very important in this ball handler, the player with the ball, decision maker, and usually it's good you get a three, but mostly of times we get a two of them on the court. So he always see the players around him. So with some overhelp, especially strong side overhelp, he must pass the ball immediately. Yeah. And of course the big man, not many big players for 1 million is ready to go and set three times the pick and roll in a 17 seconds and three times try to seal and never touch the ball. But if we get a player who can do this, just go and do this. Okay, and from the three times is big chance that somebody in weak side gone over help, or player playing the ball will too close to you. Okay, or the big guy will lost in communication, or he's gonna be too low and somebody's gonna help from the corner. Yeah. So it's something that's also not very complicated, yeah. But when we look to those examples, this is a one pick and roll. Okay, nothing. We expect rotation, nothing. Turn the ball back, attack, go back, play second one. They over aggressive on second one. Okay, and we can play our game with the three players rebounding. Patience, but ready to attack from the first second. Second one, I see Spain pick and roll and the seal. Yeah. So it's a lot of the job for the big player, especially opponent. Is some teams they switch, it's a little bit different. Some teams, these are strong big players, not ready to switch. This is crazy good. Three pick and rolls, two pick and rolls, always good spacing. You see, this is very simple offense. We say it's great offense. It's long, it's patient, and it's controlled. And with a no way, we can make a mistakes. It's not a lot of ways. That's why you need a small player who can shoot the ball over the hands. One-on-one, isolation. Hard shot, three players rebound. Okay? Spain pick and roll, nothing. Second pick and roll, shoot the ball. You see? And the number two defense right now, the Zenit player. After playing two pick and rolls, two seals, and one back screen, he just refused to go for the rebound. So we had a good chance to get the rebound. Yeah. So we are ready to work longer and harder than our opponent. And I really believe this guy is better player for sure. But we are ready to work harder this time. Yeah. And I give them tools on a court how to use it. Okay. And this is very simple for them. They don't need to think too much. Yeah. This is fundamental. And spacing, control each other, the right screen, okay, and just a mindset to always pass the ball. Next thing is discipline. Yeah, we really control our risk management. We need to control our risk management. We really need to control emotions, okay? And one thing and I call discipline is stay longer with the mismatches. And that's really important. If we find a great mismatch, we want to stay longer with the mismatch. Okay, so patience using the mismatches. Okay, it's great to get a position four. There's some kind of hard defense, double team. Okay, we bring the ball, we patient, we control. And right now, you know, after 4 or 5 passes, okay, we still keep that idea that we want to use inside game alive. Okay, and I think it's really important. Stay long with the mismatches, but not over risk when we use the mismatches. Two dribbles, switch. Great. Change the angles, nothing special. Pass, easy pass, no problem. Okay. Not a great shot, but a great opportunity to get one more. Okay, pass the ball again, shoot the ball. Stay longer with the mismatches. Stay longer with the mismatches, offer rebounding, hard rebounding. Yeah. Again, two dribbles, switch inside. Right now, our big player inside, he's not a very good like player who you want to pass the ball like in offense. That time he was not. Right now, he's much better. Yeah. So we're not staying too long on this. But for me, it's a great offense anyway. Because watch, he sets the screen, even if he's at the four, because they're switching out. We play outside our small player who shoots the ball like this. And I prepare the small players all week. I said, you need to shoot those shots. And every practice said, shoot, because there's going to be 10 times isolation. I don't care. Yeah, you need to shoot those shots. And we get a good chance under the basket. Yeah, we get our big player against their smaller player. Yeah. So I think is no turnovers. One shot we know we're going to shoot before. And a great situation for rebounding. I think it's good. And then we can control rebound. And I think this is one bad event, but we lost the patience. Right now, we move the ball, nothing. And instead of passing the ball to the pick and roll player in the middle, we start to play one-on-one against their team defense. And if we want to play like this against those teams, we're not going to be very successful. Yeah, it's no rebounding, it's no control, it's nothing. Another thing, attacking communication. This is really important. Early stage matchups. Many times, players not able to talk. But if you over dribble, they will be better. So we want to pass the ball. Passing game. Early stage, everybody, I prefer that everybody touch the ball in first 8-7 seconds. It's a perfect world. Everybody touch the ball and everybody is then ready to play in defense. That's the very simple rule. Okay. Then communication. How you attack. Change direction of the screen. Going from one side. Okay. Change direction many times. If bad communicating team, problems. Spain pick and roll. Problems. Spain pick and roll can be played in different ways. Even more problems, you know. Slip screens or slide screens. Okay, sometimes you screen, sometimes not. So this is definitely simple communication between two players. And if they're frustrated, they not like to talk too much. Yeah? This is about the transition. Okay, we want to pass. We really want to pass. We want to space. We want to be patient on mismatch. We want to pass. And if all the players can touch the ball, yeah, this is great. This is great. And if you get a 4-5 transition offenses like this, where you really cross the court, half court with the passing the ball, is perfect. You see, this is one more example, changing direction of the screen. You know, of course, great teams in the great days, they never gonna lose the points like this. But, you know, if they come to us, play, okay, not so much concentrated and whatever, not so much prepared. And when this is Spain pick and roll. This is Spain pick and roll. We use the position four instead of setting the back screen. Yeah, that's also the level of communication is different, especially in this situation. Yeah. Spain pick and roll, instead of using one screen, we use the flare screen here. Yeah, so we know the small player is going to switch. We use the flare screen. So two screens, again, small gap, shoot. Again, our big against their small, good shot for us. Okay, so we accept all those shots and we are ready for all those shots. What is important, guys, is I believe in Zenit team, we know there's some background before. Yeah, we know that Coach Plaza came and he implement a lot of defense that these players never played before. A lot of positioning, a little bit strong side help, and a lot of things. So we know that these guys, they're not going to be great all the time. So there's going to be a lot of problems. Yeah, it's like 2 weeks only or 1 week with a new coach. And some teams, like where you play Ceska, is impossible to do this because they're amazingly great, the same size sometimes, but amazingly great to protecting the ball lines. And you cannot just transport the ball easy. So no shots is easy. You cannot even get those kind of crazy shots. Yeah. But if the team is not playing very well, lanes, it's perfect. It's easy. Yeah, it's easy. Okay, response to contact. Seal, go rebound, and make a really, really strong screens. And you will see that some athletic and skinny players, they will give you the way. And this is also something that we really need to work to get something. And of course, it's the emotional side that we would love to say. We would love to say that we get some quick hitters. We get some situations that we know that somebody is not really, some players not really concentrated. Yeah, so four or five set plays, four or five quick hitters. This is all we need when we approach these kind of games. Okay. And the last thing, very shortly, about the management of the game. I think it's very important to understand how to use correctly the timeouts. Because I was trying sometimes to get some timeouts just to make some great plays, 3 seconds left in offense. Don't waste the timeouts. Do not waste the timeouts. The timeouts, when you play against the strong teams, is just to stop their runs. Never use it in a different way, I believe. Every time I use this, it was very hard later on because usually there are going to be some runs. So you need to stop those runs. Okay, so there's definitely one thing that's my experience shows that you need to be really smart. I think this is my experience, my idea. So guys, thank you for listening to me the first. Thank you very much. And I'm really happy to have a chance to be here.
Coach, there are some questions, but before the questions, it is really interesting subject that you chose with Fatih. And this is coaching philosophy, but you give a lot of titles to us. Simplify, very important word, versus a strong team or favorite team for me. Provocating style is important, not for me. And one of them is extended the defense by using the 3 points with the confidence. And one of our coaches probably ask some questions about it, but patience, discipline, communication, and how to contact, and the timeout. So those are the really important title. Thank you for your presentation. Now we go for the questions. Coach Hayri Solmaz, ask one question. Hayri abi, lütfen.
Hi, Coach. Appreciate your time and information sharing with us. Thank you. It was so useful, as Murat Koç said. What we're talking about when you're playing a team which is better than you. When you play against a team which is almost like your team, which of those things you told us, the precautions or the tactics you don't use? This is a philosophy. What I think, you use them in every condition, not only against the teams which are stronger than you. Am I right?
Definitely. Some of the parts, of course, you use every time. You want your players to be tough mentally. This makes sense every time. You know, you need to attack some of the players, but you're not happy sometimes to give a shots that's 30, 35% shot for teams that's your level. You know, you're not gonna be so much provocating them too much. Not every time, you know. So if you believe that you can win with the talent and with the skills, with the tactics, and with your preparation, I don't think you need to provoke them too much. You know, that's what I believe. One team is doing a lot, also those kind of things, is Nizhny Novgorod. If you follow the team, and they get a coach, Zoran Lukic, I think he's play, he worked in Turkey also. So he was really also, he's really about this also, just to get inside the opponent player mind and understand what he wants and what he don't want to do. Yeah, but definitely if you play the same level team, just maybe few of those things, but I believe that we are good enough to win in different ways.
So another quick question, if you let me, Murat.
Lütfen Hayri abi, devam et lütfen.
Okay. When you said, what you said was, the strong teams may not get easily prepared for you. They don't take your team into account too much, as far as I guess. When do they do so? What is your B plan?
It depends, you know, it depends on who you play. Of course, you go to your regular champs, your regular things, you know, it's something I said, you know, every time you can go to switching. This is every time you go to the switching if something happens, you know. Mostly the biggest problem can happen you cannot adjust to the speed. Okay, you get a bad offense and they score from because of your bad offense. That's the most common thing. You get a bad offense and they score easy points later on. So you need to get better on offense, and if it's impossible, you're going to lose. Yeah? So you can do nothing on this. You can change the offenses, change the players. So that's the one case. Another case might be they are really good on pick and roll. Yeah. So you can change the defenses on pick and roll. By the end of the day, if you cannot stop them with your regular defense, with the way you, with your quality, so you need to go to switching or try to do something else, disrupt them, whatever, risk. Because you can risk. This is nothing you can lose. This is not too much you can lose. Nobody expects you to win. You can risk. It's easy.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Sorusu olan var mı acaba?
Ben de sorabilir miyim?
Zafer abi, sen çaktırmadan yürüyorsun galiba.
Evet, öyle oldu.
Peki abi.
Hi coach, we are very appreciate about your speech. You did, we did up to tonight, we did more than 50 Zoom meeting like this. But today, tonight, you did the most intensive program for us. It was a great pleasure to listen for us. First of all, thank you very much for that. Second one, my question is, you at the beginning you said sometimes you are telling the players to have less aggressivity. If we do this in Turkey, I'm sure that our opponent can score more than 100 points. How you balance it? Less aggressivity and top aggressivity in defense. How you balance it?
I really think that you can put an aggressiveness on some players. On, let's say, but when I get a player, I need to choose with the money I have. Is a good, smart, or he's athletic? I cannot buy those three things. And I usually don't have a very, very athletic players. So for me, it's very hard to play aggressive defense anyway. Yeah? So that's why in Turkey, I also will give them shot, disrupt them. If they're going to score, this is a good team, and we know the reason why we're going to lose. But no layups, no easy things, too much. You know, right. That's the point.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Başka sorusu olan var mı? Any other question?
Soru yoksa ben sorabilirim ama varsa sonra da sorabilirim abi, fark etmez.
Yo, sor sen bence.
Okay, Yanis, first of all, You did a great job. Thank you for this and being with us. I have your video, so I will ask from your video to by sharing. There is one topic. This is not a thing that you are telling us, but I saw some clips while you're going under for Huertas. They make the second screen repick, and you at that time. What you choose, and for example, when you make like this kind of defenses, risking the guy and going under, at this position, for example, this is one good example. But they don't find the triangle guy at the top. When like this kind of teams, who has a little bit patient and. Find the spot up shot at the 3-point line. What do you think about the changing the defense? You are still like to go in under because, for example, Huerta's not shooting the ball from threes. He is continuous, but they are shooting from the triangle or finding the position because if you saw that, for this is very tough to perimeter defense follow. And avoid from the screen from here, and try to not be in 2-on-1 position. For sure, this guy here needs to come a little bit help or from the weak side. So you're gonna give many three-point shots. Okay, I know that your strategy maybe you prefer to give some shots, but this is very open shot from the arc. What is your idea about for the repeat defense, not for the main defense? Okay, you go under first one and you go for the drop defense for the second one, but it doesn't work and the guy is gonna make some triangle, but you like to go continue on under again, but you need to change the other things, you know, for example, maybe you will make direct switch or double team. What do you prefer for this second pick and roll situation defense?
I think in this one we wanted Huertas to shoot the ball, so we are ready only to switch on the layups. So we get a very low jump switch position, very low. You know, if the third player helps, he needs to help only in the case that the roller is open. Okay, if he's not open, he don't need to help. In this case, I don't think he needed to help too much, but of course, if we play very poorly that defense, because on a risk screen we go over, we don't want to go twice under many times. Yeah, if we get, we need to change the defenses. We cannot stay on the same. And I usually like to, let's say we play a lot against Unix, they get a column, so I put a position three against column. I got a big three, and we switch with a five. So. We try to be really aggressive, not letting him pass the ball inside. So attacking some lanes, okay, and let him play one-on-one. And just, he's smart guy, he knows, I understand everything, but we really needed to him work hard, you know, just to dribble, to drive and do another stuff, you know. So that's usually we try to go to switching.
Okay, I have one more question for the Spanish action that you do. I really like it. So. Do you at this position do perimeter switch? You set up again one more screen at this situation, and I know that you are very patient to play for the second pick and rolls if the first pick and roll doesn't work. Do you get this position or do you get this idea from another team, or do you find your way by yourself?
You mean about being patient?
No. This to set up the second screen and open up one more position. For example, you know these guys at this Spanish action, they are making a perimeter switch. So you prepare the team. Okay, at that time we're gonna make the second screen for this guy. You are prepared at this starting position like this, or you are just reading the game and then just this, huh?
Yeah, I understand. we're reading this because if the big player see that he's big guy, he's avoiding the backscreen and he's already in the paint. So mm-hmm. he's already in the paint. And many players who don't like contact, they are so afraid of backscreen that they're not going with you together, but they stepping back. So they are protecting the paint immediately. So instead of rolling to the place where the player is waiting for you already, so you make a one more screen. This is going to be flare screen, or it might be also after later the quick pick and roll again. So the big guy like, yeah, so this is definitely the read. The same read we have like the backscreen guy. We got a read if his guy is going to make a jump switch with another small player before. So you just vanish, you just go. Yeah, just go strong or weak side. It's paint pick and roll is a lot about read. I mean,
yeah. Do you think that is especially at VTB and last year we talked with you against Ventspils. Ventspils played this situation many times to force you a bad communication at your defense. Do you think that at this region the teams are mostly playing this opportunity, this Spanish action opportunity? That's why I'm asking you, your teams has many experience to read this situation. For example, Kimki with Barcelona's played many. Is this an affection on this region? Everybody is trying to play Spanish action. What do you think?
Yes, it's definitely. I think we're stealing the things from each other. Every year you see that the one team is taking the set place for another team, you know, mm-hmm. and another team is taking the set place for another team. And then when you start to prepare for some of their offenses, opponent offenses, and you see that it's really working well for you also, you take it, you know. And I think this is the case with the Spain pick and roll, that yes, many teams are running this, a lot of the teams, but let's say in VTB is almost no team running out of the screen.
What do you prefer to defense, to defend that action?
Spain pick and roll.
Yeah. What do you do?
We like to switch small and small. If we get a hedge defense, we keep hedge defense. We don't react on this. Mm-hmm. If we get a drop defense, we prefer, of course, to switch small and small most of the times. If this is an early slip, so they just not setting the screen at all, you know, mm-hmm. we get some communication rules because of this, and we get the one player in safety always. So the last guy in weak side. So he's just somebody, but it's all about the ball pressure many times. It's ball pressure and how you handle that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you also being with us here. Great
job. Pleasure.
Thank you.
Başka sorusu olan var mı? Any other question? Yok galiba. Coach, thank you very much. It was great pleasure to listen to you, and thank you for your sharing your strategies and your thoughts and spending your time with us. It's great pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you once again. You guys are doing great job, is for sure. I never think that Latvia can do something like that, you know. So we are just hiding from each other the information instead of sharing this. And this is great you're doing, and keep on going like this. I think it's great time you use the time properly, and it was an honor to be there. And one more hello to my friend Fatih.
Okay.
Thank you again. See you.
Fatih, teşekkürler.
Ben teşekkür ederim abi. İyi akşamlar herkese.
İyi akşamlar. Thank you.